Bureau phone line. Check out favrates.com and go with the home team, Mississippi Farm Bureau. Eric Sorensen joins us for the first time this year as we are now just 10 days away from the start of the college baseball season. Eric writes at d1baseball.com and other places. What's up, my friend? So good to see you.
Well, look, Rich, I got the call from your producer this morning, and I was pinching myself. I was like, when I get a call from Richard Cross and the gang, that means college baseball is almost here. So I'm kind of geeked, and I almost feel like I'm not quite ready for it yet. But yeah, it's something we're certainly looking forward to at the D1 baseball site. You know that.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. So we've talked about a lot of different things leading into the season. We'll just focus on the SEC today.
Sure.
It feels very different this year going into the season than it did just a year ago, where you had guys going into the year like Kumar Rocker and Jack Leiter and Doug Nikhazy and Hoagland and guys at Arkansas. And we didn't know what we knew at the end of the year about Will Bednar and Landon Sims, but what we knew was arms were everywhere.
Yeah.
This year, it feels like there are a lot of questions at the front of the rotation for a bunch of teams.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it, because it's kind of weird because you know all these teams are going to be good, like LSU and Vanderbilt and Mississippi State, Ole Miss, but you're certainly looking at a lot of question marks with, you know, Vanderbilt not having those two big guns, but they've still got guys that are going to be high-round draft picks, Patrick Riley and Christian Little, guys you might not have heard much of before. They're going to step to the front. Mississippi State, you know, I mean, they're going to be going with Landon Sims apparently in the weekend rotation, trying him out at last I heard. So that's kind of a question mark. LSU certainly a question mark with all their pitching they lost, but they're kind of rolling the dice with Devin Fontenot, moving him from a closer's role to a starter's role as well. And that hasn't worked out. LSU has a proud history of not having that work out in guys like, you know, Carl Hess and Jaden Hill last year. I mean, he was the big stud top 10 draft pick. And they used him at the front of the rotation, and he got just, you know, rocked by Oral Roberts. I think his ERA ended up above 6. So, yeah, a lot of question marks this year, and but you still have to look at it overall, Rich, and just say, you know what, this is SEC caliber pitching that you know is going to be good. Let's just throw it out there and see how it performs. You know, they're probably going to be okay, but it is weird to have these many question marks all around the SEC.
And I guess the fascinating thing is if we look up in May and go, man, would you believe the arms in the league once again? You didn't know their names at the beginning of the year, but you do now.
Right. Yeah. I guess, too, that I'm forgetting about is Florida with Hunter Barco and Brandon Sproat. You know, both of those guys kind of the same way. They're going to be high-round draft picks. Maybe not first round, but they could be. Barco could be going the first round. But, yeah, you're just going to have a lot of guys that, you know, come April and May, hell, maybe even earlier than that, you're going to see guys that are really dominant. And it's going to be just the same old ACC. The only difference is this year we kind of questioned it a little bit more than we did in past years, you know?
So the opposite of that is the offensive piece. We were talking earlier today. Last year you had two guys in the SEC that hit more than 20 home runs. Wes Clark at South Carolina, and guys, help me out. Who was the other? There was one other. I don't remember who the other one was. Point was, there were only two. You could make an argument that there are going to be 10 guys this year that hit 20 bombs. And I don't think it's a crazy argument.
No, Rich. In fact, I'm just looking at your Ole Miss Rebels right there at the very top. Gonzalez, Graham, and Elko, all of those guys. Yeah, all of those guys are back. They both had double-digit numbered home runs. And, you know, they got the short porches in some of these parks, too. So I think that's going to be – I think you're going to see a return of power. And, of course, that LSU lineup. Geez, not since the 27 Yankees has it been that good of a lineup put together. It seems like, we should say that way.
At least at the top. And you know what? I'm curious. I'm curious what Jay Johnson does with, is it 2-3-4? Is it 3-4-5? And what's the combination with Jacob Berry and Gavin Dugas and Dylan Cruz?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you have to figure Trey Walker is going to be the guy that leads off. Trey Morgan's going to be the guy that leads off. But yeah, you could just interspace anybody like Gavin Doughty or Gavin Dugas and Kay Doughty as well. Just you can intersperse anybody in there, and they're just. I think it's a thing where you kind of mix it up early on and just see what clicks and go with the hot hand type of thing. But it'll be interesting to see how. It'll be interesting to see how LSU does with all the expectations as well, because everybody's talking so much about those sticks. You know, maybe they get a little shaky start because of it. They're pressing a little bit. That happens a lot of times, but so much talent there, man. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna be hard pressed to see them actually not having a good year, you know?
So you live on the West Coast. You keep up with Pac-12 baseball more than we do. Obviously, there's some folks in our neck of the woods that were pretty tuned into what Arizona was because Ole Miss Arizona Super Regional last year.
Yeah, that's right.
This transition, Jay Johnson, Tucson to Baton Rouge. Do you like how this works out long term?
Very weird. I won't say he's not going to succeed because he's done great wherever he's been. You know, as an assistant USD, that's San Diego, Nevada, where he took him the NCAA tournament, and then down to Arizona, where he took him within a single of the national championship, I guess you could say. But it's just weird. He's such a West Coast guy. And some of the people I talk to out here, some of his good buds are kind of like, you know what? He's got a great gig there. He's not going to fail because he's got so many resources. But this is a guy that's kind of coming in from out. It's like Jerry DiNardo coming down to coach the football team. They loved him at first. And then when he started to kind of slip up a little, they're going to jump on his back, man. They're going to be in his grill saying, hey, you got to start winning. So, yeah, I think they're going to have a short leash on poor Jay. But Jay's such a good coach and such a good guy. I think he's going to do fine there. But again, it does kind of concern me that, as Tony Kornheiser says, in the SEC, they'll put the sold sign out for you on your front lawn if you have a bad, you know, hell, in LSU, if you have a couple of bad weekends, not just a bad year. So I think he's, you know what, Rich, though, to be honest with you, I think he's going to do great because he's got more of a facility and resources at his hands than he's ever had. And he did so well with Arizona and Nevada in the past. I think it kind of shows. You know, it's kind of like Paul Maneri when he came down from Notre Dame. If he can win at Notre Dame, he's really going to do well with the resources at LSU. And, you know, he did win a national championship in his first few years. So I see Jay Johnson doing pretty well. But any quick slip up, dude, he might have some angry Cajuns after him, you know?
Eric, you might have just caused an issue. So the makeup of the state of Mississippi is obviously heavily Ole Miss and Mississippi State. And the farther south you go, Southern Miss. The number of LSU fans on the Mississippi Gulf Coast that may have just driven off the road when you compared their new baseball coach to Jerry DiNardo, they may be sending you the bill for the car repairs.
Oh, believe me, Rich, I'm an LSU grad, so I know what they're all. I know what that fan base is all about, and you know, same with Ole Miss, Mississippi State, just so rabid. It's both great and a little bit of a curse at the same time. And poor Jerry DiNardo, he gets such a bad deal. But, yeah, he kind of had a rough go of it in those last few years.
Can I get Texas A&M with the hire of Jim Schlossnagel?
Yeah, that's another one that seems a little weird to me because he was – because I don't know if we talked about it before, Rich, but I remember visiting with Jim Schlossnagel at TCU, and I asked, hey, Jim, where do you live, by the way? And he points over from the stadium where we're at, points over to this house, three houses away. He goes, that's my house right there. I was like – you live that close to TCU, you have this much success, I'm never going to put you out as a guy that's going to be, you know, a candidate for another job. But here he is going to their rival, sort of. You know, it's a team that the postseason, TCU and A&M have met many times.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah, and kind of the same thing with Jay Johnson going from Arizona, which has a great backing. But you go from that to LSU, and you know, it's a quantum leap jump. TCU's got great backing as well, good facilities. But now he's just amping it up even more at A&M. So even though it seems weird to me personally, I think he'll do fine. And you know, A&M's certainly got one of the more rabid student sections of any college baseball place in the country. So, you know, they're going to love him now as much as they used to hate him because they used to always get beat by TCU to go to Omaha. But I think he's going to do fine. He's proven it. I mean, this is a guy that proved it at UNLV before he went to TCU. He won 47 games in the desert there, so you got to figure he's going to be able to, you know, kind of adapt to wherever he's going to go to.
All right, give me your winners. Who wins the East? Who wins the West this year?
Oh, my God. The West is so bizarre because it literally all the teams are going to be really good. In fact, Rich, I even had Alabama in my eight for Omaha right after the last College World Series. I had them in my eight for Omaha, but then I didn't realize that Connor Prelip wasn't – he's their first-round draft pitcher. But everybody else, you know, Auburn might be down a little bit, but my God, Ole Miss, Mississippi State, obviously Arkansas and LSU. It's hard to pick against Mississippi State, and I know that's kind of kissing ass a little bit, but there's still so much talent there. 9 of the 12 pitchers they use in Omaha are coming back. So I'm going to go for now with Mississippi State, And then I have to go with Vanderbilt. I had them at number three in my preseason rankings for Athlons magazine. So I'll go with Vanderbilt just because they just reshuffle guys in and out of there and can win with just about any combination, you know, with Tim Corbin still at the controls. So those are my picks, but man, take them as shaky as you want to, put it that way.
Well, that's fair, and we will allow you to amend them perhaps as the season goes along.
Yeah,
hope this is the first of many conversations over the next few months, my friend. Great to catch up, and always enjoy talking ball.
Yeah, thanks for sharing the airwaves, Rich.